realize that that's no human power. That definitely comes from up above, and we feel like we're just four vehicles for a message that the Lord wants to put through us into people.
And all of your religious, strong sense of religion in your life.
Oh, yeah. When we're on stage, it definitely comes across. We feel something working through us. We know that we're not the only ones up there. There's something else going on that we can't explain.
How many of you came out of a tough background?
All of us.
We all have our different stories.
Yeah.
We all came from different parts of Philadelphia. Real far.
But why do you say tough? I mean, you laugh because that doesn't even define it, huh?
Right.
Oh, yeah. I mean, we've all been I mean, we don't come from middle class housing. I mean, we come from the low class housing in Philadelphia. I mean, you know, project areas and the urban areas where, you know, you have one.
And who was the predominant influence in your life?
Mothers, most definitely.
Mother,
and father, and my grandfather.
Yeah, my father as well. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but the three of you were raised by your mother.
All of us.
Did you know your father?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, we still do. I mean, in some cases, we get along very well with our fathers now. It's just that, you know, we know we're a lot older now, and we understand their situation then as adults. So, I mean, you know, everyone makes mistakes, and we just learn to understand them and deal with them. You only get one father and mother in this world.
How do you pay back your mother for being there for you, for playing
the
role?
You can't.
Yeah,
it's difficult.
It's not so much
a payback. It's just something that you love doing for your mother. Yeah. You love to bring joy to your mother. You know, so we just try to make their lives a little bit better now, you know.
I just think being in the position that we're in now, you know, where we're able to do the things that we've always wanted to do, and if we could have did it back then, we'd have did it as well. Mm-hmm. So I mean, we just have more resources to make things a lot easier for our parents.
Yeah. Who are your heroes? Who'd you look up to?
Let's see. I guess it's a different situation for different people. I guess, you know, I looked up. I had a few brothers in my house, along with an older sister, and they were.
Batman was a favorite.
they were like influential. As far as like just seeing them and their examples, and of course my mother, and also just people around my neighborhood. Though we struggled and we lived in a, you know, not so clean or whatever neighborhood, it was like there was still like a togetherness with a lot of the people, like with each block, with each street. There were people that looked out for everybody, and it was like those people, those older guys that I used to watch play football and basketball and just see go to work and things of that nature, and kind of bringing me up that way, well, helping my parents bring me up as far as like just making sure I do the right things on the street, and those are the people that inspired me.
What was the first big break?
The first big break for Boys to
was on a, what was the first break?
We were at a local radio station event in Philadelphia that's held every year, and Michael Bivens, who's the president and CEO of Biv 10 Records right now, he was in a group called Velvet DeVoe at the time, and we snuck backstage. And
I know this story. It's a great story.
We snuck backstage.
I mean, you were going to get backstage that night. There was nothing to keep you from getting back there.
And the thing about it is that we snuck backstage.
And you prepared to sing when you got there.
Oh, yeah, ready to go. But we weren't really, like I said, we weren't really looking for a record deal. We just wanted someone in the music industry to hear how we sounded, give us their opinion, and then we were going to go back home with our regular lives. Yeah. But luckily we ran into Mike, and, you know, we were big fans of his group at the time, so we asked him, could we sing for him? He said, can you do it now? He said, yeah, so we sang on
What'd
the spot.
What'd you sing?
We sang a song by his group called Can You Stand the Rain?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And we sang it a cappella, and he just took everything from there.
And he became
our manager,
and still is your manager.
Exactly, and he's the one who just signed us to Motown Records, along with Mr. Gerald Busby.
He still isn't our manager now.
Yeah.
Right now, we have two new managers, Johnny Cocker and Clyde.
Then there was a time in which you were also, you sang something on one of one of Eddie Murphy's movies.
Boomerang.
Boomerang.
That was under the Michael Bivens administration.
That was the first break, was it?
That was the first big stamp.
That shot us out. The way that came about was amazing. It all worked in a beautiful like circle. The album, we had the album out. The album, you know, kind of was dying down. Yeah. And Michael Bivens, we were over at Michael Bivens' house, and he said, Babyface and L.A. Reid and Darryl Simmons has a song that they want you to do on the Boomerang album. Yeah. Boomerang soundtrack, and we heard it and instantly fell in love with it. And when the studio did it, and
yeah, and then the next album was what?
The next album was our Christmas album.
The Christmas album. So Cooley High was the first.
Yeah. Cooley High was the first.
And then the Christmas album, which was called
Christmas Interpretation.
Yeah, and this is the third album.
Yes.
And how many is this sold already?
Close to worldwide, about 10 million.
That's not half bad, is it?
No,
we'll take 10 million. Somebody's listening. Eat your heart out. All right, let's take a look. This is from the music video, and we'll talk about this album more. The music video, Thank You. Take a look. Take a listen.